everyone, and welcome to the Secretary of State for Work and Pensions and his assistants also. Welcome to the seventh meeting of the Social Security Committee. Could I remind everyone to turn off their mobile phones, and they do interfere with the sound system. No apologies have been received today. So we go straight to the agenda. Agenda item one, the decision on taking business in private. Our first item is regarding after our evidence session, if we wish to take the evidence we've heard in private. Is the committee agreeable on that?
Yes.
Thank you very much. And our main item of agenda today is an evidence session with myself, Mr. Green, the UK Government Minister for Social Security. Welcome to the Scottish Parliament, and also your officials, Richard Cornish, Devolution Director, and Denise Horsfall, Work Services Director, both in the Department for Work and Pensions. Mr. Green, you have indicated you wish to make an opening statement.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to you and the rest of the committee. I'm very pleased to be here, the first DWP Secretary of State to appear formally before a Scottish Parliament committee, and thank you for your welcome too to my officials, Richard Cornish and Denise Horsfall. It's an interesting time. Clearly, the Scottish Government is at the start of its journey in developing and delivering social security in Scotland, and clearly the Parliament as well will be assuming a new and distinctively different role in scrutinising the Scottish Government's choices and decisions in this area. So this is a unique moment in devolution and the transition of powers from Westminster to Scotland. I know that in this process our officials have been working well together, and I look forward to that relationship continuing. It's also a personal pleasure to be back in Scotland so soon after my last visit, where I saw great work done by a number of voluntary organisations. I visited Kibble Works in Paisley, where young people who face barriers to employment are helped to experience the benefits in terms of well-being and confidence that having a job brings, which is very central to the purpose of the government's welfare policy. And I also listened to views of a number of organisations on the front line about how my department can continue to develop and improve its work, because there's always room for improvement. And other ministers in the department, the Minister for Disabled People, had the opportunity recently to be part of Scotland's hosting of Rehabilitation International. And I know she visited a number of organisations at the same time. So, as I say, we're at an important juncture for the delivery of welfare in Scotland. We're implementing the further devolution of powers that all parties agreed for Scotland in the Smith Commission agreement relating to welfare powers. In July, we commenced 11 of the 13 welfare sections in the 2016 Scotland Act. These included provisions in respect of creating new benefits, topping up reserve benefits, discretionary housing payments, universal credit flexibilities, and employment support. And the majority of those are already in force. They came into force from the 5th of September this year. The housing DHPs come into force from April of next year. And we recently agreed, and I'm sure the committee is aware of this, at the request of Scottish Government ministers, to explore a unique split competence approach to the commencement of the remaining welfare sections of the Scotland Act, covering existing benefits, DLA, PIP and carers allowance, and we remain committed to transferring these powers as soon as it's practicable, and very importantly, as soon as it's safe for claimants. And the powers are being transferred are unprecedented in their scope, and mean that from a situation where, until recently, virtually all welfare provision was being legislated on and designed centrally, we now face a completely different landscape of both governments delivering benefits in Scotland. And the Scotland Act makes this Parliament one of the most powerful devolved legislatures in the world, and makes the Scottish Government directly accountable to its citizens in those areas that are being devolved. So I'm sure this means an increased role for this committee in reviewing how the Scottish Government takes these powers forward, because as anyone exercising ministerial office knows, with power comes great scrutiny, and so it should. And now that the Scottish Government's consultation on how to do this has ended, I would encourage them to set out their policy plans as soon as possible. I appreciate that this committee will play a significant role in scrutinising that. And as agreed in the fiscal framework that's been agreed by both governments, funding for devolved welfare powers transfers at the point of devolution. Under the situation of split legislative and executive competence, as we will have for some of our benefits, funding for welfare benefits transfers to the Scottish Government along with the executive competence at that moment. And again, I think at that point, this committee will become an even more key player. The successful devolution of £2.7 billion worth of welfare spending is a huge task. We all recognise it will take the Scottish Government some time before it's in a position to deliver welfare programmes fully, and I'm fully committed to working with them at all levels to make sure that implementation is effective and to ensure awareness and understanding of the changes for all those who are touched by them, and perhaps most crucially of all, to deliver devolved welfare safely for those people in Scotland who rely on this support. And in that regard, I want to pay tribute to the hard work and determination of the thousands of DWP employees in Scotland who day in and day out provide support to those who need support. Their contribution is very significant, and I'm sure committee members regularly visit their local job centres and will recognise that too. So it's incumbent on both governments to manage the transfer of powers during this transitional period in a sensible way. There are clear accountabilities on both sides, and the needs of citizens must be at the centre of this process. I should also say a word about the UK government's approach to welfare while I'm in front of you. In 2010, we inherited a broken system, a system where there were too few incentives to move from welfare to work, and one where too many of our fellow citizens were simply taken off the books and forgotten about. And that's what we've been trying to change. We've ensured work always pays through reforms like universal credit, while ensuring a strong safety net for those who can't work. And spending on disabled people, for example, will be higher in every year of this Parliament than it was in 2010. But of course, we need to continue to review and reform the system based on what we know works. That's why earlier this week I published, along with the Department of Health, a green paper, which is designed to improve the way the welfare system responds to people with health conditions. It has reform of the work capability assessment and statutory sick pay and the fit notes. It also, I very much want to see employers step up and play their part in helping people with long-term health problems and disabilities get into work. So we've created a disability confident business leaders group. And on the health side, I think one of the big mindset changes we need is to see work as a beneficial health outcome in the jargon. In other words, a good job is good for your health as well. There's overwhelming evidence of that. So we'll be working with the various health bodies, and I look forward to working with health bodies in Scotland as well, to make the benefits of work an ingrained part of the health workforce approach, and to see a culture of high ambition for disabled people in this country. So as a closing thought, clearly delivering on this devolution settlement is a learning process for all of us. We share the ambition to maximise the opportunities it can bring and to avoid any unintended consequences. It's vital to ensure that the new and any existing services work effectively in tandem, and that we try and avoid additional complexity and cost and a disjointed approach. So, as I say, I look forward to the Scottish Government providing further clarity on its plans as soon as possible. We now have an opportunity to implement a new shared welfare landscape for Scotland, one that continues to deliver in the best interests of Scotland while obtaining the benefits of the UK welfare system and transforming lives, giving people skills and opportunities to move into work and help them address the difficulties they may face in their daily lives. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Mr. Green. Obviously, we're looking at two different areas, one about the devolved powers and obviously one which is still reserved to Westminster. And we've decided that we will talk about the devolved powers at the Scottish Parliament at the beginning, a couple of questions, and then we can go on to any reserved matters there, basically. So I'll start off with the questioning. You mentioned about the devolved powers. We know that only 15% is coming to the Scottish Parliament, 85% is still staying with the Westminster government. And you mentioned also in your opening speech about cooperation between the DWP and the Scottish Parliament as well, and between the different departments and the governments to ensure a very smooth transition, so that no one, and I think that we all agree on this, no one falls through the net and everything is done smoothly as possible. Can you tell me what work is ongoing with the DWP staff and staff from the PCS union who actually will instrumental in delivering these changes? Is there any ongoing work regarding looking at DWP staff transferring to the new, you know, social security agency that we have here? Certainly we've had evidence from staff, PCS staff, that there has been no ongoing talks in regards to that. So could you perhaps elaborate on that a bit?
I mean, obviously, until we know what the actual proposals from the Scottish Government are, it's quite difficult to take a definitive position on individuals. Denise, you're working on a daily basis on this. Do you want to?
On a daily basis, we're working locally and also at a national level concerning the impact of some of the early changes around employability. But this is around taking the space that the work programme had before. So there isn't any impact on my staff at this point in time. They'll be referring and working with different providers or the same providers sometimes. But the areas you're thinking of is probably around the benefit side, and certainly those decisions haven't been made.
So we have had a number of discussions with trade unions and in fact just last week I personally had one of my regular catch-ups with all three trade unions specifically on what we're doing in DWP on Scottish devolution. And although the communications within the department have been relatively low profile over the last year or so, because we're until we get more detail about kind of what will happen and when things transition to Scottish Government, there hasn't been a huge amount to share with staff in DWP, but we've certainly been doing some communications and as I say, just last week I was meeting with PCS and the other trade unions.
It's just that there has been concerns raised, and you mentioned the fact about you know, the staff and job centres who we've all visited and have raised their concerns you know, about lack of communication and a time scale. So we don't have a time scale and when basically you're going to work even closer with the staff of the job centres?
I mean, I'll speak at as it were, at the ministerial level and then let Richard say about the at the workforce. I mean, clearly we have the joint ministerial committee on welfare where I attended my first meeting last month and it was a constructive and sensible meeting. But as I say, to some extent, the details of the perfectly, you know, sensible questions about timescale and so on will depend on the Scottish Government coming forward with its own timetable, both for legislation and indeed the structure. I mean, I understand they've just finished their consultation on how they want to organise this, and obviously I think we're all waiting for them to come up with some conclusions as a result of that consultation.
Yes, and I think on the point you touched on before, Convener, the Scottish Government haven't indicated to us that they want to transfer UK DWP civil servants into their new agency that they've announced they're creating. And indeed, a number of the people in DWP that work on the areas that are being devolved don't necessarily do that from Scotland. Some of the benefits that are being devolved are currently dealt with by places in the northwest of England, for example. So it's not necessarily clear that people would automatically transfer over from DWP. And of course, actually, a lot of DWP staff in Scotland deliver benefits and services such as job centres, but they deliver benefits and phone inquiries for all different parts of the UK from Scotland. So they would be remaining working for DWP in the main.
I mean, that's just one part of it, talking about the agency, but the actual communications between, I mean, it has been raised with the staff, basically, and I understand you have a memorandum of understanding as well, which says that you will work together. It's just to put some flesh on the bones. Is there any movement, I mean, from yourselves in regards, we know that they work in different areas and they won't all transfer over to the agency, but to ensure there is a smooth transition, there's got to be some form of communication between the DWP, yourselves, and, you know, the people who deliver it here in Scotland, whether it's in an agency or whether it's working out with an agency. Is there a timescale for it then? I just want to try and pin this particular part down because people are concerned. There's nothing worse that we're looking at this and we're putting this forward and then there's no safety net in case something happens. People fall through the middle.
So as I said, the virtually entire DWP staff will still be working on DWP benefits as a number of the people that work on Scottish claims for the benefits that are devolving don't necessarily do that from Scotland. So I have given reassurance to staff in some communications over the last year or so that's our expectation. And we will start having more communications with staff. I plan on doing some more telephone conference calls of all staff in Scotland in the next few months. But we are, as I said, quite dependent on the Scottish Government sharing with us the time frame for when they want to actually start taking on some of the services themselves. And until that point, it's difficult to give a lot more flesh on the bones to staff because actually the messages won't be fully formed.
I mean, it's not a blame game or anything. It's just to ensure that people do get the services that they want. So to be entrenched in the position where you want this one to come forward or that one to come forward, all I'm asking is, when are you going to get together and speak to the staff that's going to deliver this? You mentioned telephone, you know, teleconferences, etc. Would we in this committee get an update on when you're talking to, you know, the various staff? Because I think it's really important to get this correct and right and working properly.
Yeah, I mean, we undertake a number of different communications methods with staff on a, you know, a daily basis, as just as business as usual, and that will continue. And I wouldn't expect to sort of be able to kind of give you almost a daily commentary on that. But certainly, as I said, I have done some communications with staff in Scotland and elsewhere, and I am expecting to do that on an ongoing basis in the coming months.
Thank you very much. I think Ben McPherson wanted to then Adam.
Thank you, Convener. Just to, in terms of the context we're in, first of all, Secretary of State, thank you for coming to the committee, and I appreciate, as you mentioned, that you are the first Secretary of State that's come to committee, and it's good to welcome you here. And I'm very grateful for the very constructive approach that's obviously been outlined there and within some of the comments there too, in terms of going forward and the memorandum of understanding and how we implement the new powers that are coming to this place. But I think it's also important to consider the past and the present. And I thought it was interesting on Monday, there was almost an implicit recognition from yourself in terms of the publication of the Green Paper around the fact that there have been significant failures and problems with the rollout of welfare reform since 2010. And obviously there's been a huge amount of distress to our citizens and to many of the constituents that we represent. So I wondered if, in terms of the fact that you're here as the first Secretary of State to the Social Security Committee, whether you wanted to take this opportunity to perhaps acknowledge and apologise for the unnecessary and highly disturbing anxiety, suffering and hardship that many of our constituents have faced since 2010, particularly in regard to working assessments, working capability assessments, the sanctions that have been imposed and also the cuts in the wider austerity agenda and welfare reform. And I just wondered if you'd like to reflect on that, given your comments on Monday.
The comments on Monday, the Green Paper we produced, were explicitly building on the new types of things that have been introduced to the system, notably universal credit, which is the biggest new development, a benefit that always makes work pay, which avoids one of the problems that have bedeviled the benefit system for decades in the UK. You mentioned the work capability assessment, which was of course introduced in 2008 by the Labour government. It wasn't invented by the coalition government in 2010. We inherited the work capability assessment. There have been five different reviews of the WCA since it was introduced because there is nothing that can't be refined and improved. And I hope that the measures that will flow from the Green Paper, well, you know, the questions we're asking in that Green Paper, are designed to make it do its job, which is, and what I want to do is remove the sort of binary nature that it's got into, where it puts people into groups, and you are designated as a member of this group or that group. I want it to be much more personal, so it can achieve the sort of responsiveness that I suspect we all want to achieve, so that an individual can be helped in the best way possible for that individual to either gain access to or regain access to the world of work, for, you know, all the benefits that brings, not just in terms of money, but in terms of self-esteem and control over your own life. And if you like to try and divide that help away from the pure, you know, what benefit am I going to get? I think it's that confusion that I regard as being slightly unsatisfactory. But I do think, you know, you need to assess people to know what help they've got. And I do think at the end of the system, you need a sanctions regime. It's very much the last resort. And what I think is interesting, and I know how controversial sanctions are, that actually sanctions have halved in the last year, both under Job Seekers Allowance and ESA. In Scotland, they've fallen further than other places. There's been a 60% fall in JSA sanctions in Scotland in the year to March 2016. And the on average, only 2.4% of JSA claims result in a sanction. So absolutely there, I think they need to be there, but also absolutely they need to be there only as a last resort. And that's why we're trialing here in Scotland one of the improvements that may work. Let's see what works. An early warning system, which gives claimants an extra 14 days to provide further evidence for reasons of non-compliance. We're still at the relatively early stages of that trial, and we get the full evaluation early next year. But that's the kind of improvement I want to bring about to make the system work better for, you know, your constituents and, you know, mine in England as well.
Just a quick follow-up on that. Thank you, Secretary, and it's good to hear that determination to make this system work, and I think an implicit recognition there that there have been significant problems. I also noted kind of earlier this week that you dismissed the film I, Daniel Blake as a work of fiction, but unfortunately for many of us, the constituents that come to see us at surgeries, that story that is told in that film is by no means an act of fiction. And I think what would be useful for us going forward, if not an apology, is a wider recognition of the suffering and distress that's been caused to many individuals, most vulnerable individuals in our society, from single mothers to the disabled to those with mental illnesses. And I just think that, I want to give you an opportunity just to acknowledge that before we move forward together to think about how we use the powers of this Parliament to do things better with the 15% that's coming.
It's absolutely, it sort of goes without saying, but I'll say it anyway, not the intention of anyone connected with the welfare system, whether, you know, ministers or staff of DWP, to cause distress. The system is there to help people, and I see it as an essential part of my job to try and set up the structures and set up the organisation of the system so that it is there to help. You know, we can. I genuinely don't know what your own personal view is about a sanctions regime. As I say, I think one is necessary as a backstop. Other people I know don't. Similarly, I know there are some people who think, you know, that there shouldn't be any kind of work capability assessment. I don't agree with that either. I think, you know, you need some assessment, but the assessment can be made better. So, you know, I can only assure you and the committee and everyone that the whole purpose of the system is to help people and also to use the benefit system as a way not just to give people financial help, which obviously it does, but also to give them the tools, if we can, to take more control over their own lives, to make their own lives better. That seems to me the basis of any humane welfare system.
Thank you. Adam Tompkins.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Secretary of State, and welcome to the Scottish Parliament. It's very good to see you here. I wanted to, in the same way that Ben McPherson was, I wanted to ask you about the this week's Green Paper, which I note was a joint publication between your department, the DWP, and the Department of Health. And one of the impressions I got from the Green Paper, and I suppose the first question is this the right impression to have got, is that one of the things that is coming right into the heart of the government's thinking about social security is the joined-upness of social security, on the one hand with health, but also on the other hand with employment, and that the function of the welfare state is not merely to help those and support those who genuinely cannot work, but also to do everything it can to move people off benefits and into work. And I wondered if that was, a deliberate, innovation on the DWP's part to jointly to publish this this green paper with the Department of Health. And I wondered also if you could reflect a little bit on the policies, I understand it, of the United Kingdom government, a very ambitious policy to halve the disability employment gap. And it's a success story that we have so many people in work in the United Kingdom. It's a success story that we have so many disabled people in work in the United Kingdom. I think the number is 360,000 people with a disability in work now who were not in employment 2 years ago. But to go from there, and that's significant progress, but to go from there to a point where we have managed to halve the disability employment gap, which is, as paragraph one of the Green Paper says, is one of the most significant injustices in the United Kingdom today, is a very ambitious policy. How can we realise it?
Two huge issues there. I'll try and be as brief as I can, partly because I'm very passionate about both of them as well. Absolutely, the DWP and the benefit system cannot solve problems of welfare on its own. We will devise benefits that try and help people, but particularly in the example of you give of the Green Paper, there are more than, across the UK, there are more than 7 million people with a disability. That is a huge pool of talent and potential. And one of the things that strikes me as hugely ironic is the way every 4 years now we've got into the routine of everyone in the country hugely admiring Paralympians, and we think, look what these people can do despite the fact that life has dealt them a difficult hand. And then everyone goes back to their day jobs and tends to regard disabled people as, we feel sorry for them, they've got a problem and things like that, not recognising that there are millions of people with talents to do great things, and we've got to make it easier for them to express those talents and do the great things that are within them. But to do that, you need the health system, particularly, for instance, with mental health issues, to diagnose them earlier, treat them better, recognise that there are conditions that come and go, and that therefore people's working life will be different because it may be more sporadic. And how can we help employers to be able to cope with that? The health system has to do that. You're right about employability, the skills system. Has to recognise that if somebody, moving away purely from people with disabilities, but more generally, if somebody is at a stage of their life where they haven't got the relevant skills, then it's for another arm of government than the DWP to make sure they've got the skills so that they can take advantage of the many work opportunities there are out there. And that's why the Prime Minister has set up a social reform committee on which all the relevant departments are sitting, so that we can drive forward the social justice agenda, which we're very determined to do, in a joined-up way. The other point about... your second point was...
Okay.
The employment gap. Disability employment gap is, Yes, it's challenging. I think this green paper is the start of a very long perspective. People often accuse politicians of being short-termist. I'm being deliberately long-termist here. I don't think there are levers you can pull that you can make huge differences over 18 months or so, and governments have got to commit themselves to 10-year activities. But as you say, we are getting more disabled people into work than ever before. The gap is so big precisely because we've got more people generally in work than ever before. Roughly 80% of people who are non-disabled but are of working age are in work at the moment. That's historically at a high level. So, as I say, what we need to do at all stages, the health system, the welfare system, the employment system, if they can all work together, we need to get all the ducks in a row to make a real difference. But if we can do that, then I think we can make a significant dent in the disability employment gap. And we can do that in a steady, consistent way over the course of many years to come. And that has to be the target.
Could I just pick up on the part about the disability and getting people with disabilities back into work? We've heard absolute horror stories with people with disabilities basically being forced to take jobs that they just can't. I mean, the debate yesterday, one of the contributions was a gentleman who couldn't walk. All he could do was use the finger of his hand, and he was told he could get a job texting. So it's really concerning that whilst it's admirable that people who want to work, and yet work is a great way forward, that people are being forced into work with a disability. And could I draw your attention to paragraph 114 in the Green Paper? Obviously they talk about this particular group with people with life-threatening illnesses and disabilities are put into this group, which they don't have to always go for a disability work assessment. But in paragraph 114, they say that there is currently no requirement for people in this particular support group to stay in touch with the job centre. Besides engaging with reassessments, we could consider implementing a keep-in-touch discussion with work coaches. This could provide an opportunity for work coaches to offer appropriate support tailored to the individual's current circumstances, reflecting any changes since their work capability assessment. And this light touch intervention could be explored as a voluntary or mandatory requirement. Now, I'm quite worried when I see that word mandatory requirement. Mr. Green, are you saying that people with disabilities will once again have to go through this revolving door of work assessments?
Well, not all of them. Indeed, one of the announcements I've already made is that somebody whose capability assessment says they're not fit for work and who has a condition that cannot get better, will either stay the same or degenerate, anyone in that obviously very unfortunate position, we will stop reassessing. I do think that's one of the beneficial changes, and that will be a huge weight off the mind of very many people. And I think that's the kind of change entirely sensible.
Sorry for interrupting, but how do you define this? And it's a question, obviously, maybe others will raise as well. Do you have a list of conditions?
It's not the condition. Well, we know which conditions degenerate or which conditions don't improve. I think the key is it's got to be individualised. It all fits in with that pattern, that there will be people who at some stages of having, say, multiple sclerosis, can work. And at some stage it may get to the point where they can't work. What I'm saying is that if they've got to the point where they've been assessed as being unable to work, then with a condition like that, there is no point calling them back in 2 years' time saying we're going to reassess you, because we know it won't have got better. And there are very many people like that. I think the point about not just putting people into what we call the support group and leaving them there, which is what's happened in the past. One interesting historical statistic is that when this system was created under a Labour government, the estimate was that about 10% of people would go into that group. They'd be assessed. People would think, you know what, I'm afraid you're never going to be able to work, so here are the benefits for you. And actually, it's about 50% going into that group. So, I mean, forecasts are always wrong, but that seems a huge difference. And I suspect that the, if you like, the 40% who are unexpectedly or unexpected to the people who made the predictions in 2008 in that group will contain large numbers of people who may well have conditions that go back and forth. As I say, this particularly applies to many mental health conditions, mm-hmm. and the largest growth of people with disabilities at the moment are those with mental health conditions, I think partly because mm-hmm. we're getting better at diagnosing them and recognising them and saying we can do something to help these people. And yet people like that, that, again, there's a lot of medical evidence that they are precisely the sort of people who shouldn't think, I have been told I cannot work, I will never work again. Many of those people could work, certainly for part of the time, and would benefit from work. Their lives would be made better. So those are the sort of people we want to keep in touch with so that they don't feel they've just been left by the system.
Thank you very much for that. Just the paragraph 114 does concern me about light touch, and but I mean, I'm sure others will come in. I don't want to hold the
paper,
the
whole, so do contribute.
Yeah, I certainly will, and I'm sure this committee will also, yeah. Our individuals as well. Gordon Lucas.
Yes, thank you, Convener. Secretary of State, thank you for coming to speak to this committee. I have a question about engagement, which I'll perhaps focus in on two issues. So the first of these is, how constructive has been the engagement between UK government and Scottish government officials? And perhaps you could comment on that. And second, a perhaps more specific matter, and this relates to something that is covered in the Green Paper, and I think specifically in the chapter that refers to taking action together towards the end of the Green Paper. Paragraph 297 refers to sharing effective practice and being active partners with government by third sector organisations. Now, that's a particular area that I'm interested in, and in certainly in my area, Edinburgh and Lothian, and indeed throughout Scotland, we have very many churches, community groups, voluntary organisations and others in the third sector who are actively involved both with government agencies and with individuals who receive benefits. And I met with two of these this week alone, one of whom raised the very point that you touched upon, an organisation dealing with disabled people, and the need to be flexible because identifying an individual's particular skills and looking at developing that and finding work for them in areas where they are very good, very able, as opposed to focusing on the disability. They welcome this approach of having a flexible approach to things and also this attitude towards working between government agencies, voluntary organisations and individuals. How important is this sort of engagement and working together with third sector organisations to the United Kingdom government and the approach which is presaged in the Green Paper?
Okay, thank you. On the communication with between officials, I'll ask Richard to comment since this is his life full time, 90 hours a week or whatever unfair hours we put on him. All I can say is I've observed in the 3 months or so I've been Secretary of State that relationships are very good and very constructive and practical and realistic. And as I said in my opening statement, we're at this transitional phase where powers are being passed over. Within the next year or two, those powers will start being exercised here in Scotland. And so it's all real now. People are going to have to run systems and pay benefits and do all the nitty-gritty nuts and bolts of the day job of the DWP. Here in Scotland. And so my limited experience is that I detect good and constructive relationships, but you'll know better than me, Richard.
Yes, thanks for your state. Yes, so we are doing a huge amount of engagement with Scottish Government and have been now for nearly 2 years since Smith, and as the bill went through and to become the Act. We have done a lot of activity on a number of different fronts, so it might have been from the capability building, so we've done a lot of work to help Scottish Government, both with transferring some small numbers of people on secondments, or indeed they have recruited one or two DWP staff. And we've run somewhere in the region now of about 100 sessions, workshops, visits, you name it. We've done it in terms of activity with Scottish Government and helping them to get a better understanding of how the current landscape is developed, and in quite detailed areas such as IT, in terms of finance, in terms of fraud and error, all of the different policy areas, but also all of the operational areas and the technical areas. We've been doing a lot of work with Scottish Government, pretty much now on a daily basis, and I have a team of around 30 people working full-time on Scottish devolution with the Scottish Government, with their counterparts there. So a huge amount of activity has been going on, and I could wax lyrical about it, but for brevity, I won't say any more.
Thanks. And on your second question about the third sector, one, absolutely, they are essential participants in this. They will have contacts, ideas, ways of working that are unfamiliar to governmental organisations, which may be better. And so we can learn from them. And in particular, I'm keen to have them running individual programmes in local areas. You'll often find those are the best programmes, actually, to particularly in some difficult areas, that will actually make a difference. On one of the visits I've made, I was struck by, it was a general needs housing association that said one of the things it had taken to doing, it had plugged into a different charity in their area who gave work advice, and so they were moving their tenants towards that, and they were upfront about it. They said, if our tenants are in work, we get our rent paid more reliably, so this is good business for us, as it were. But nevertheless, I met some of the tenants who said, in one case, I think they'd been out of work for 15 years or so, had sort of got into trouble as a man in his early 20s, and drugs and alcohol and all those sort of type of problems, and now in his late 30s was in regular employment for the first time in his life. That came entirely from an initiative by an individual NGO. So it's the flexibility and ideas that they bring are absolutely essential, I think, to running a successful welfare system that does actually encourage people, as I keep saying, to take control of their own lives, which is what I want to achieve.
Can I just add to that a bit? Sorry. Yeah. On a local level, job centres continuously work with their partners, again, for all the reasons that Secretary of State said. So we run also community representative groups at a national level in Scotland and also at a local level. So if there's partners that we haven't touched, really like to hear about them in that locality, because there's no doubt together we get better results. People get better outcomes than us trying to do things individually. So there's always the opportunity through our partnership teams to actually engage.
Thank you. Paula McNeill.
Thank you, and for giving us the opportunity to question you this morning, Secretary of State. I did want to return to the question of sanctions that Ben McPherson raised. We debated last night in the Parliament, led by the members' debate, led by the conveners, at research by Glasgow University and other universities, including Sheffield, about the question of sanctions. And a number of things came out of that research, and I wondered if you'd seen it. One is the disproportionate effect it has on young people in terms of sanctions. And I think one of the key issues is, it's not the principle of sanctions, but the disproportionate nature of it and the way that it's being applied. So they aren't just one-off cases. There are numerous, thousands of cases where people have missed appointments and either the DWP hasn't realised that they've been told this, or someone simply made a simple mistake and they've been sanctioned for 4 weeks, 6 weeks. And of course, sanctions can be as long as 26 weeks. I just wondered if you had any plans at all to adjust the sanctions regime to take some of this fairly well-researched evidence into account, in perhaps reshaping under your leadership, if you like, a better approach to this?
I think, I mean, with sanctions, as with every other part of the system, I'm always looking at it, and clearly as a new Secretary of State, I look at all parts of the system. And I haven't seen the details of the Sheffield Hallam report. They didn't send it to us in advance, but I will obviously read it in detail over the next few years. I hope we can establish, if you like, a consensus that the principle of sanctions is not a bad one. But also, I'll happily add to what I hope is a consensus that nobody wants to put sanctions on to no purpose or to drive people away from the system. The purpose of the sanction is to have a backstop so that if somebody really is not cooperating at all, really is not trying to get into work when they could, then that's not acceptable. It's not fair on all the other people who are paying their taxes to pay the benefits. And of course it's important, and I'll look at the individual cases. Of course it's important claimants are given the opportunity to provide good reason for not complying. I mean, that you know, that seems to be the nub of quite a lot of the complaints. And as it stands, claimants can ask for an explanation of the decision, ask for it to be reconsidered. They can appeal against the decision to an independent tribunal.
Seems to take an extraordinary amount of time, but I'm sure you know that.
Yeah, well, it yeah. can do. And it, again, in all areas of the system, we try and minimise delays. And the one other thing I would say, of course, is that that we have hardship payments. There's now a well-established system of hardship payments, and specifically on the point of delays, because it's relevant to that, we've accelerated the system so that they now paid within 3 days. And I'm sure there are examples, but if you look at the system in the round, the applications for these hardship payments are down 43% for JSA claims and 29% for ESA claims last year. And I hope and think that that's because the system is working faster and better. If it's not, I'll keep reviewing it.
Do you want to
follow up on that one?
I just have
no. My second question, so the Scottish Government are committed to providing the option of payment of universal credit twice monthly for social tenants to have their housing cost elements paid directly to the landlord. I mean, for many claimants, it's just a better arrangement. But what you have said, or what has been said to the committee, is that that wouldn't be possible for Scottish ministers to exercise that option until the full rollout of universal credit in 2022. But that's something that you'll be discussing in the joint ministerial group. I just wondered, is there any scope for bringing that forward? Because I think I would be certainly very keen to support that idea. I think people can manage their money better if they have it more regular intervals, and I think it's a very, very sensible option. I'd like to see that sooner, if that's at all possible.
The flexibilities we've agreed. I mean, we completely agree on the last point, and I think the reason universal credit is designed as it is, with basically monthly payments, is to replicate the world of work as much as possible. And increasingly, obviously, people who are on universal credit may well be in work anyway, so it gets them into the world of work that many people know. In terms of the flexibilities, it's a practical problem as to whether they can be introduced into the system before we've rolled out the completely full service that we that we'll be introducing over the next 5 or 6 years or so. And this is for the very good practical reasons that the last thing I want to do is for the system to be put under strain, because that's the point where you get delays, that's the point where people don't receive payments to which they're entitled. So we've agreed that those flexibilities can be introduced, but it can only be when the systems can cope. Richard, do you want to add to that?
No, that's right. And the discussions are ongoing with Scottish Government, so both through the Joint Ministerial, as you alluded to, and also a lot of work at official level. So we're just in the process of exploring what might be possible. And I think the sense we have is that those flexibilities would be able to be introduced before 2022, I think is our current assumption. And we're just seeing with Scottish Government to understand exactly what they want to achieve and all of the detail of that policy so we can try and work out what the solution is. But it will take, Secretary of State touched on, we want to make sure that the system is able to do those flexibilities in a way that will not cause any problems for anyone. So it's more a technical kind of IT issue rather than anything else.
Thank you.
Alison Johnson.
Yes, thank you for joining us this morning. My first question relates to sanctions and devolved employment programmes. Your predecessor committed to referring benefit recipients to devolved employment programmes on a voluntary basis, and I'd be grateful if you could clarify for the committee that that is a commitment you intend to honour.
Yeah. I mean, I think the question, the sort of interface between the, if you like, a sanctions regime and the employability programmes, the work programmes, is a practical one. It boils down to what happens if somebody is not going to cooperate at all. What happens if they refuse to? So if you run a regime, and obviously we don't know yet what the Scottish Government is going to propose with its employability programmes, but I get the impression, talking to Jamie Hepburn and others, that they may well want to run a completely voluntary system. If they do that, as I say, what happens with difficult cases? I'm interested that your sister committee in Westminster, the Work and Pensions Committee, said in a report in 2015 that they thought sanctions were a key element of the mutual obligation that underpins the effectiveness and fairness of the social security system. I suspect it will be an interesting piece of work for this committee to see whether you can devise a realistic system that doesn't have that as a backstop, because around the world, as well as the Work and Pensions Committee in Westminster, people have come, broadly speaking, to that conclusion.
But you're of the view that this is a matter for the Scottish Government?
The skills part, the sort of employability part, is a Scottish Government programme. I'll be interested to see what they say and what they do.
Okay. Thank you, I appreciate that. I'd like to focus now on universal credit. The Musselburgh Job Centre, which is in Lothian, the region I represent, has introduced the full service in March this year, and I've been approached by housing associations who have concerns that the live service and the full service aren't quite enabling them to deliver the same service previously. So perhaps that might be a question that officials could help respond to. But also concerns have been raised about the fact that people are having to wait 6 weeks for universal credit, and this has led to referrals to Citizens Advice Bureau. They're saying the Musselburgh Citizens Advice Bureau has noted a notable increase in people who are asking for advice how to get through this very difficult period, and also it's having an impact on referrals to local food banks. So I'd be grateful if you could clarify the differences between the live and full service that's impacting on housing associations being able to help clients, and also the difficulties for people when they're having to wait for 6 weeks to receive any assistance.
Denise, John.
Yes, so I'll take that one. Right, so you're absolutely right. We've moved from universal credit live service to full service. Live service is for single customers, so who are on working age benefits, who made a new claim, as opposed to full service is anybody that would have applied for a variety of benefits, including housing benefit, including working tax credits, including employment support allowance, and as well as traditionally job seekers allowance. So it's all benefits that those claimants would come to us for universal credit on in full service. Mm-hmm. We've been running since March. We have been working consistently with local housing associations at a national level and also locally to eradicate some of the gremlins in the works. There are gremlins. It's about information being provided systematically and that being received in an appropriate way. So it's not delaying the customer's benefit. Customer's benefit of 6 weeks, it's expected that a customer receiving universal credit, it will take 6 weeks to receive because it's in arrears. So the support in that case is around advances. So there's three issues there. Around housing, we're working locally and also nationally to resolve the information flows that are going between us. The second issue is around 6 weeks. 6 weeks is because it's an arrears benefit, so it will take, with waiting days, 6 weeks for somebody to receive benefit, and around 6 weeks. And the last issue is that if somebody can't wait for that first payment, then there is an opportunity to receive an advance. There's also referrals, obviously, to places like Scottish Welfare Fund and the rise in food banks. I don't know. Nobody's actually come to me around that issue at the moment.
Okay. One of the issues that the housing associations have pointed out with this move from the differences between live and full, keeping live universal credit claims for 6 months after a claimant has found work was very helpful for those in temporary or seasonal work, and that seems to have been discontinued in full service, so people are having to start again.
I can't comment on that. I'm not aware of that being a policy change.
Okay.
Yes.
Come back to you.
Yeah, yes. I'd be very grateful if you could.
That's not the intention at all, is it? The intention is to keep claims open so that if there's a fluctuation in income, mm-hmm. then it takes away it de-risks the reclaim to benefit.
Can I just ask quickly about that 6 week delay? It seems a remarkably long time. Has there been any intention at all to review that, to look at what could change? It must be quite unsettling for people who are having to rely on advances. Why does it have to take so long?
The calculation is around waiting days to start with, so that's 7 days waiting, and then it mimics actually the world of work again. It's paid in arrears.
It's basically designed as a monthly payment, so mm-hmm. when you've got through, as it were, the bits of the system that you need to do, you then have the end of the month to wait for, so and that can be as much as 6 weeks. It's a sort of one-off. I mean, I appreciate when you're changing, that will be that. Yeah, that's why we have the advance payments. But after that, hopefully, it's a teething problem, as it were, or a difficulty for people that when they're in the regular flow will obviously go away.
Mm-hmm. I would just be very grateful if attention could be focused on that, because I do know that referrals to food banks during that time are quite notably peaking. Thank you.
Gordon, you're fine. I thought you wanted to come in the back of Alison. George Adams.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Secretary of State. Thanks for coming along. I'm not a subtle man, Secretary of State, so I'll say to you now, some of the things that my colleague Ben McPherson has mentioned regarding our constituents, horror stories of the current system. So I will not be less than subtle when I'm talking about this, but I will take the idea that the Green Paper does say our vision is to create a society in which everyone has the chance to fulfil their potential, where all that matters is the talent someone has and how hard they are prepared to work. Now, if we take that on board, then why is it in Scotland currently, Inclusion Scotland told us that 48% of disabled people are living in poverty? And we also have a situation where Black Triangle Campaign came here and told us as well that basically the regime of PIP assessments is actually sending people to actually go to commit suicide. That's the situation. It was so strong by the Black Triangle Campaign that actually he almost accused you of sending murdering people. So really, if we've got a situation here, is that part of the unintended consequences that you mentioned earlier on, or is that helping people, as you said on more than one occasion today, take more control of their lives?
There's no evidence. I think bringing people committing suicide into political debate.
It was an evidence that we took at this committee.
Unfortunate. Clearly, every suicide is a tragedy. There are complex reasons behind everyone. And to, as I say, to try and politicise individual tragedies like this always seems to me to be very unfortunate. The figures about PIP, since you bring that up, are, you know, in Scotland, the amounts paid for PIP and other disability benefits have had a real terms increase of £294 million, or roughly 16% over the course of the last Parliament. So the amount being paid to people who have extra difficulties because of their disability is actually going up under PIP. What the evidence shows is that this is a benefit that is helping more people. It's a wider benefit than the old DLA, and in particular, it's something that people with mental health problems find easier to access than the legacy benefits it's taking over from. So I just disagree with the black triangle analysis of the situation.
We'll move on then to, since we're talking about PIP DLA, then to the idea that you mentioned multiple sclerosis earlier on in your submission, and it was actually quite hopefully naive what you said regarding someone with multiple sclerosis, because, you know, is that not part of the problem, that we have a system that doesn't understand the conditions that people have and the long-term conditions that they're dealing with? Is that not the problem, Secretary of State? And also, you mentioned Paralympians. Was it not the case that Ben Rowlings and Carly Tate actually ended up in a situation where they went through the assessment and could have lost their mobility vehicles? And these are the people that you said, we talk about them as heroes, and then they're going through your system, and then effectively, these heroes are becoming zeros.
On multiple sclerosis, I'm not, you said what I said was naive, I'm not clear about
you
that.
Said that someone with MS could at various points work. Yes, they could, but the problem would be that what employer would have difficulty dealing with someone that could maybe work one day a week and then for the next five could actually not deal with that work? It's the chronic fatigue alone. The point I was making was individual conditions, understanding them. That's the point,
yeah,
Secretary of State.
As it happens, I do understand multiple sclerosis quite well. I have an employee who has multiple sclerosis and have had for many years, so I know quite a lot about being an employer of someone with multiple sclerosis. Thank you. You can do it. And I know it's a degenerative condition, and therefore there will come a point. The point I was making was in terms of the announcement I made about not reassessing people, that if you have reached a point where you can't work at all and you've got a degenerative disease like multiple sclerosis, then you're not going to go back to work. And reassessing people like that seems to me to be, apart from anything else, pointless as well.
But you've spent a fortune assessing people up to this point.
Sorry?
You've spent a fortune at this stage assessing people when it used to be a desktop condition, and there was only about 3% of people on DLA who were actually found to abuse the system.
Clearly, any abuse of the system needs to be stopped, but I want to make the system more sensitive, and that's what I'm doing. If there are individual cases of anyone that you want to bring up, do let us know.
And you may regret that.
We'll look at them.
Can I say one final point? You answered a question with Jeremy Corbyn with regards to Daniel Blake, and it just so happens that the writer of that is here today, and Paul Laverty is here, and he gave me this book on the way in, and it might be some light reading for you on your trip down to London, so you get the opportunity to actually experience it. And I do believe that the writer told me, Paul told me, that this was actually based on some of the ideas and the research that he had done, and also we can back it up as constituency MSPs at some of the horror stories that are coming from your actual so-called welfare reforms. So I'll leave that there for you, Secretary.
That's very kind, as I say.
It's signed as well.
That's very touching.
Thank you very much, George. And I can remind members, you know, of the committee that in the Scottish Parliament we always treat people with respect. And also, Secretary of State, when you mentioned suicide and the Black Triangle, there are absolutely. I have a constituent who unfortunately committed suicide after getting a letter from the DWP. So there is evidence there in that respect. But I just wanted to put that point that in the Scottish Parliament we do treat everyone with dignity and respect, as we would expect to be treated, and the people here and outside as well who are going through this process. Mark Griffiths.
Thanks, Convener. Secretary of State, thanks for coming along to speak to us today. There's a clear distinction between powers over particular benefits which have been devolved and which are reserved, but there is that grey area in the middle. I think a welcome power and a significant power that the Scottish Government will have to top up benefits which remain reserved. I just wonder if you're able to outline what the process would be, what any potential costs would be if the Government decided to top up an area of reserve benefit, and particularly there's a strong lobby outside this Parliament to top up child benefit to alleviate child poverty. I wonder if you'd able to talk about what the process you see, whether the Scottish Government would do that through their own agency, or whether the Scottish Government would make a payment, and that would be that would operate through DWP.
It's a good question, because you're quite right. The Scottish Government does have these powers to top up if it wants to. It will be different for different benefits. I think we are engaged in a feasibility study at the moment about carers allowance, are we not?
Yes.
Richard, John?
Yeah, so just on one example, the Scottish Government have commissioned DWP to do a feasibility study to look at how their policy to pay a different amount of carers allowance could be achieved, and we've accepted that commission, and we're working on that at the moment to explore what will presumably be several different options where we may be able to help the Scottish Government achieve that policy. It depends on what that feasibility study identifies as the options, to therefore what the solutions might be, and then the choices for the Scottish Government to make around how they might deliver those. But we have been looking at carers as a kind of specific example, and how they are delivered, whether, you know, the sense that Scottish Government will have a separate agency seems to be the steer they've given so far. So we will be looking at ways in the carers allowance example of how the information that DWP has might be able to be shared in some format with Scottish Government to achieve their aim of topping up. But the principle, I think, you know, it will work in a number of different areas where we're able to help Scottish Government to achieve their aims.
And do you have a timescale at all for that feasibility study on carers allowance?
Yes, so we've committed to undertake the work within 3 months, so we're expecting it to be complete by the end of December.
Okay. Thanks for that, Convener. A separate point that I wanted to raise as well, Secretary of State, you may or may not be aware of, I think, the sad case of Alison Shaw, who died in Glasgow in July. Alison's family took a selfless and courageous decision to keep her life support operational for 3 days to allow her to donate her organs and to allow other people a better standard of life, or to save their lives. As a result of that decision to keep her on life support for 3 additional days, she qualified for her pension, which meant that her husband, her widower, then did not qualify for a bereavement payment. I wonder, Secretary of State, if you agree that that is right, that a family who selflessly and bravely make that decision and to keep a family member on life support so they can donate their organs are then financially penalised. And I wonder if you'd look at that particular case.
Well, obviously, I have seen the case, and I'm sure all our thoughts must be with Mrs. Shaw's family. This was clearly, as you say, a brave decision to allow her organs to be used for donation. I know that my department has been in touch with them to explain the situation, in particular how they can appeal against the decision. Your last question, yeah, would I, as it were, change it? I think there's an important principle in all cases that politicians don't give individual benefits. That on individual cases, it's the law that does it. You know, we as politicians pass laws that then get implemented, and departments have to obey the law as much as anyone else. And so, you know, there is a legal appeal process, which is the appropriate way to do that, rather than an individual minister intervening. But obviously, as I say, my department is I know in contact with the family to explain that process to them.
Thank you, Ruth McGuire.
Thank you, convener. Thanks for being here, Secretary of State, and I'd just like to welcome your guarantee that the Scottish Government will have power over conditionality and sanctions for the employability programmes that we have. I wonder just if you would maybe reflect a little on some of our people facing additional barriers to work, be that disability or poverty, and just the impact that punishing them further through cuts has, in that it actually inhibits their ability to take part in society and to gain employment. I wanted to talk a little bit about your green paper. It states that you want to ensure people are able to access the right employment and health services at the right time in a way which is personalised to their circumstances and integrated around their needs, and I think everyone would welcome those warm words. However, my question is, if that is the case, why are you merging the work choice and the work programme and reducing the budget for employment support? The Green Paper also states that a new personal support package offering tailored employment support, which Job Centre plus work coaches will help disabled people or people with health conditions to access. What will the benefit of that be?
I mean, the answer to the first question is that what we want to do is concentrate our support precisely on those who benefit most, hence the new work and health programme. And what the support package includes is a place on either that programme, the work and health programme, or work choice for all eligible and suitable claimants, depending on whether it's before or after April 2017. But also we'll be able to offer another range of help, additional places on the Specialist Employability Support Programme. We'll be having job clubs delivered by peer support networks, and a lot of the charities who work in the sector themselves have said they think it's peer-to-peer help that's particularly effective. That in a sense you need to know what the condition is before you can explain both to someone else who may have the same condition as you how they can best benefit from what's available, and also explain to employers. And we're creating 200 new community partners who've got disability expertise and local knowledge in individual areas, again to provide specific expertise. There's another list, but I won't go through all of it. And I hope this shows that what we're trying to do is spend the money we have as effectively as possible. So that and what we're also doing is listening to those involved in the sector, actually providing practical help. And it's it's reasonable to observe that a lot of the big charities who work in this area, notably Scope and Arthritis Aid, welcome what's in here, and I know want to get to grips with these specific programs because they believe they can help people in a more effective way than they've been helped before. So as I say, it's about concentrating where it's needed, and the personal support packages will be precisely that. They're what they say on the tin, instead of just lumping people into groups and saying you are this sort of person, you have to try and personalise as much as possible, because that's the practical way actually to make a difference to people's lives.
Just very briefly, thank you for that response. I suppose I would just urge you to listen to the real experts, who are not those people, but our people in our communities that go through these programmes, and really hear them when they say what does and doesn't help them to contribute in society, which they all wish to do. And I don't think there's many people who don't want to work, but there are real barriers there in terms of poverty and disability and health conditions. So I hope you'll take that opportunity.
No, absolutely, I mean, and hence the peer-to-peer idea. But you're right, it's removing those barriers. And some of them are unnecessary barriers imposed by actions of the state, and others are really deep-seated and ingrained barriers of people's attitudes. And I do see that it's literally taken a generation for women to get near equality at work. We know there are still problems there, but actually the mindset has changed hugely in the past generation. Wholly good. You know, this might be a generation-long fight as well to make sure that the barriers to disabled people being completely involved in the workforce I appreciate, you know, there are many people, and I would be one who would say all the barriers to women having full participation in the workforce have not been removed, but we have made huge strides. I think that's unarguable over the past generation in that. Let's do the same for this other group.
Just very briefly, and I don't want to, we could go back and forward all day, and I'll not even touch on gender equality here. I think I would just urge caution talking about changing attitudes. Certainly my experience, and I mean perhaps looking at the consultation responses that the government, the Scottish Government has done, it's not the attitude of people who have challenges that getting to work that needs changed. It's actually the system, it's society. Most of these barriers are not about the attitude of people who need that social security safety net. There's structural barriers in it, and it shouldn't take a generation to change. And I would be deeply ashamed if it took a generation to change that.
Great. I mean, if we can do it fast. But I completely agree. Sorry, we don't differ here. I agree. It is society's attitudes, ingrained attitudes. One of the reasons why we set such great stress in the Green Paper on employers' attitudes. There are some very, very good employers who are very enlightened on this, and I want to spread that good practice across the world of work. I've talked about gender equality, just as there are employers who are more enlightened than others on that, and for successive governments, successive other agents in society have tried to spread that good practice around. I want to do the same thing for to help people who have a disability.
Thank you very much. Just one very, very last question. I wonder if you would agree or perhaps look at this particular part. Obviously, sanctions and conditionality is the biggest, huge, with people are facing, barriers there, particularly with the sanctions. In your Green Paper, would you perhaps looking at just put a moratorium on the sanction part, conditionality, until you get further evidence? The evidence we've certainly received from Sheffield Hallam and Glasgow University seems to imply, it doesn't imply, the figures are there, from 2010 up to 2016, sanctions have been used excessively and basically forcing people back into work. Could you? I don't expect you to give me that commitment, but if you would think about it even.
I always look at new evidence. I can only say in response that more than 70% of JSA recipients and 60% of ESA recipients say that sanctions make it more likely that they'll follow the rules. So there is clearly evidence on both sides of this.
I will always
make a commitment to look at evidence.
It's not about following the rules that are set. It's about trying to, treat people fairly and with respect and getting them back into work. But I'll leave it at that. And thank you very much to Secretary of State. We've also received various written questions. I know some members have more questions to ask. Would it be all right for this committee to put these in writing to you? Would that be all right with yourselves?
Certainly, yes. Yeah.
That's great. Yeah. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you all.
I'll formally close the meeting now. Thank you.